Thank you, sir. Respected session chair, dignitaries in the audience, my senior colleagues and friends. First of all, on behalf of Bharat Electronics, I would like to thank the organizers for having given me an opportunity to come and share some of my thoughts in this August gathering. You have been hearing a lot about platforms and aircrafts and the challenges in design, development, deployment, engineering, manufacturing, and all that. I come to one small part of it from the platform perspective, but a very equally important and a very critical requirement for flying objects, and that is communication. So we have actually come a long way from radio being used as a channel for wireless communication to transmit voice messages to today communication being an asset for information superiority. And particularly in the military domain, communication technologies play a very critical part in the platform's success, whether it's a flying object or whether it's any other military platform. So here I have attempted in my presentation over the next 20-25 minutes to cover the challenges that are facing us from providing effective wireless tactical communication technologies. And I have taken the example of aircraft, and that to the military aircraft. So I intend to present. The topic by looking at the requirements of an airborne networked communication, and what are the challenges we face, and possible solutions, and of course keeping future in mind. How can these technologies be used to provide upgradability? And since we all know now today's communication is a network of communications, it's not a standalone system. Having created a network, we should have a very robust network management system to make this communication resource effective. So let's just quickly look at the motivations or the requirements from the tactical perspective. Obviously, we need to provide secure and robust digital network communication among rapidly mobile users, and that too in a digitized battlefield environment. The critical requirements naturally would be to provide not only agile communication, but they should be jam resistant, and they should be interoperable with legacy systems. They must provide a seamless voice and to go into combat data connectivity. The security plays a very critical role. Resistant communications from the security perspective, and of course, since I said they are all going to be networks, they have to be self-configuring and self-healing to be really effective. So if we define ourselves, those are the requirements for the military communication for the airborne platforms, then what are the challenges? We can define them from three: resilience, reliability, and redundancy. And it can again be split into two parts. One is on the communication side of things. The other one is the network side of things. Looking at the communication, it's a wireless communication. It's a tactical communication. So it has to be robust and secure. And it should have ECCM features because it is going to go through a very hostile atmosphere. And it has to have the protection as a against the countermeasures. And naturally, it has to be high speed, both in communication data payloads as well as agility. And it should have a network which has ad hoc capabilities in it. And naturally, it has to support data along with voice. And the greatest RF challenge is to provide such communication gadgets when they are all co-sited on a flying platform. So these are some of the challenges when we look at it from the communication perspective or the wireless electromagnetic radio perspective. Now, looking at from the network side, the network is supposed to be robust and resilient, and it should provide different functions in the form of a network. It's not just a connectivity, but it must be capable of providing the services that the network is capable of. It must have simultaneous operation, and naturally, as we see in the next few slides, that stacked orthogonal nets become a critical requirement when we have to look at airborne communication. And it will have to have support for multi-hop routing, quality of service, and latency becomes a very important issue when we have to make a mission successful from the communication perspective. Looking from a very, simplistic graphical way about how communication are going to be deployed, is you can see in this slide that there is a connectivity from a ground station, not only to one aircraft, but maybe a different platforms of different families of fighters and other aircrafts, but also to other airborne flying objects like the UAVs, or including the satellite communication. And this is an integrated communication system which has to be designed and deployed if you have to get the best features out of why the communication in a networked form has been envisaged. So there is not only from the AVAC side of things or the airborne controller side of things, it's not only the mission planning or the mission execution, but the platforms, the success of the platform when it's flying in the time in the perspective of its health management, as well as its communication between other aircrafts and to ground and to air, are a very important requirement. This is we'll skip the slide, we'll come to it a bit later. So these challenges, when we have to keep in mind that we have to provide security and jam resistance, as well as providing high data rate to network of multiple simultaneous users, this itself is a great challenge on its own. Now, to add to this, we have to add increased volume and granularity of information exchange, because ultimately, if we have to have information superiority, it is to what granularity that we exchange information creates the kind of advantage that communication channels of today's technology can provide. So ultimately, as it was shown out very graphically in the previous presentation, whatever we design has to be designed in less power consumption, less size, and more effective in the time, more optimally used from the technology perspective. So we are also actually using this communication as a relative navigation. The challenge here is actually the source and destination in a communication for an airborne platform are both fast-moving nodes, or could be both fast-moving nodes. And this creates a great challenge to provide the navigational information in the form of a communication link. Now, precise participant location and identification are also typical challenges for airborne communication. So they are also infrastructure-less, ideally. And if we keep these challenges and these requirements in mind, what are the possible solutions? Solutions, again, we begin with a radio as a simple wireless, a gadget with a transceiver, with an antenna and a radio communication channel. But then today's radios are network-enabled, so they can be addressed, they can be switched, they can be used as a router, and they can be used for not just communicating bits of data or information, but they can actually form a plethora of network nodes. And if we have to make these network nodes to support the kind of tactical requirements, they can be stacked in different various layers of network, as we'll see in the next few slides, that this becomes actually a force multiplier when we have to look at stacked kind of information transfer. And wireless communication ultimately is a radio and electromagnetic spectrum utilization. So it will have all the physical channel challenges based on physics of transmission, propagation, and various other errors that are brought about by either multipath or the various other interference or information degrading sources. And if we have to survive all this, you may have to have multi-hop relays. That means the source and destination can go through a kind of a network which is not just one emitter to one receiver, but the destination can be reached through different forms. So we need to build network communication systems which can support multi-hop relays. And then only they will form a resilient network. Again, as I said, to make all this happen, there is a precise participant location and identification, which is very important, because today we are using communication for situational awareness also. And ultimately, all of this has to be managed by a very resilient and robust network management tool. So these features, if we again split it down into subparts, we can go through in summary about message standards, frequency bands, frequency types of data transmission speeds, synchronization related issues and latency related issues, or error correcting and control coding schemes and encryption. Because messages can be different for different applications, some of them can be very fixed or very short bursts of messages. Some of them, depending on the type of communication services that we need to provide, they can be variable messages and they can be very bandwidth, high bandwidth capability kind of messages. And if we have to use this kind of messages to incorporate a communication link between a source and a destination, we will have to probably choose one of these types of frequency bands, whether it's a short-range communication in VHF or whether it's a high data rate, maybe short to mid-range communication in UHF, very large range communication with UHF SATCOM, and so is the very high data rate L-band communication. So depending on what we need to communicate, the RF engineers have to select one of the frequency bands, take these messages in whatever forms they are, and put them into a data rate where the bandwidth is taken care of, whether it's a 1 Mbps or a 2 Mbps. These are just examples I've given. And if we make this as a wireless kind of an information transmission agent, ultimately to make it work in a digital mode, the network has to be first synchronized. So the time synchronization challenges are themselves quite elaborate. And whether it's a clock with a very high accuracy clock or a clock derived out of GPS, they can be used as time synchronization agents. And ultimately, the success of communication depends on reducing latency. So mission-specific requirements play a crucial role in designing this network for minimum latency. And naturally, when they are all in burst communications and data communication and wireless all put together, they are prone to errors. So they have to be supported by error detection, error correction, and coding schemes. And all this put together becomes some sort of a communication, networked, wireless communication channel. Now to add to this, adding to the military requirements, they have to be encrypted. So this adds another payload to the kind of communication. So whether we use it for surveillance or target sorting or air control or EW reporting and coordination, all these are types of functional requirements an airborne network needs to support. So the requirements are different, the payloads are different, the wave wireless wave lengths are different, data rates are different, synchronization schemes could be different. So ultimately, making a mix of all this, we will have to create a network for effective data forwarding and battle space awareness. So this creates the next challenge, that is how to design the network. The type and the number of participants. First of all, decide how big is your network and how to make this data path go through from one end of a network to any other end with minimum latency. The line of sight constraints, the relay requirements, and the electromagnetic compatibility requirements create the architectural requirements for a network. And this architecture should also support frequency hopping or any other kind of ECCM, and message and transmission encryption, amongst other things. And message types, as I said, variable formats and fixed formats, and operational use, as we have seen, they have to support all this. So all this creates the architecture for a network. So the most commonly used architecture for this kind of airborne networks are time division multiple access, or the TDMA networks. And to make simultaneous multiple orthogonal nets are going to be useful for separating out information that participants on the main net do not need to receive. Because we have to support so many kinds of payloads and so many kinds of different diverse applications on our communication link, it's better to have a different payloads amongst a different cluster of users on a different net. And the challenge here is to provide these nets such that they are orthogonal or non-invasive or non-interference creating amongst themselves. So ultimately, the basic from the network perspective, it comes down to creating a data structure which is time domain, multiple access. And the whole network engineering boils down to creating a payload supported by a synchronization mechanism, and as well as keeping in mind what is the propagation delays required so that the whole network supports resilient communication. Ultimately, it has to go on a wireless scheme also. So we need to have a carrier requirement, whether it's a single carrier or a frequency hop set to support multiple users, becomes the next challenge. And if we have to have non-continuous transmission, this, although it makes handoff simpler, but it is the transmission of data from a source to a destination is in packets which may not go in one go, but in a repeated kind of slots. So the slot allocation depends on not only the destination and the source, the payload and the environment, but many other requirements of latency as well as network synchronization. So ultimately, the success of creating such an airborne network which is going to be reliable and resilient depends on creating this TDMA structure in the form of slots and epochs which support error-free communication with very little delay. So network synchronization based on time standards are going to be the crucial requirements. Now, added to this, there is another challenge that this has to be a dynamic TDMA. It ultimately becomes a dynamic kind of a scheduling algorithm. So it requires not only that time slots are allocated to a user on a fixed basis, but depending on what he needs to communicate and to whom he needs to communicate, the network can give him dynamically reserve a different number, variable number of time slots. So all this actually goes on increasing the complexity in the digital domain. But then once we have understood how to configure this kind of a network, today's networks are all capable because technology supports us today because they are all configurable networks. So using these kind of technologies, we have come from a single kind of a TDMA network where time slots were defined to a stacked kind of multiple nets which are orthogonal in nature. And here is an example where about 128 kind of stacks have been, nets have been stacked, and different types of communication can go without any distortion or disturbance from one net to another. So ultimately, what are the other challenges to make such a network happen is, as I said, synchronization and ad hoc networks. Now, not just we have to synchronize a network in a static mode, because these are all mobile networks and they are ad hoc in nature, the ad hoc mobile networking topologies have to be supported when we design airborne data networks. So collection of mobile wireless nodes forming a network without the aid of any infrastructure becomes a very critical requirement. So the characteristics of ad hoc networks are not only they are dynamic and fast changing, but they are used when there is a limited channel bandwidth and of course the variable channel capacities. So characteristics and applications dictate how we can exploit an ad hoc network. And this is one example of, it's not taken from any airborne platform, but a cluster of computing agents, how they are connected connected together through routers. And if they start becoming mobile and ad hoc, they add the challenge to a military kind of requirement where we have to support self-organizing, self-healing, redundant and resilient topologies. So each of this is actually a technological area of work. That is, scheduling algorithms or networking topologies or routing protocols. And if we mix all of them up, and then it provides a kind of a networking topology that can be connected between a cluster of users. So this is just an example where we take, for example, an airborne ad hoc network. The top slide shows that there is a network which has been in place between a cluster of flying objects, and it is being routed by a router in between, which is actually a tanker. In the next one, actually, after the tanker has departed, the whole network should reconfigure itself seamlessly so that all the node identities can still communicate to work without the kind of a routing which was there in between. Now, these are the kind of challenges that one has to face before he actually configures a network. So another example of networked airborne communication is that this today is being used as an aircraft to supply information where terrains are actually obstructing the propagation of whatever radio frequencies between the source and the either a target or a desired destination. So using an airborne communication link, you can provide bridges in communication. For all this, again, it is ad hoc network that needs to be supported. So all this I have tried to cover in a very brief and simplistic way. What are the challenges and what are the requirements and probably what are the solutions? Ultimately, we feel that if a network has to be supported in an upgradable manner and it has to be reconfigurable, the solution is through a software-defined radio. And the software-defined radio, by its software communication architecture, supports development of waveforms which you can use so that in this kind of architecture, you can provide layers of security and the link applications and the modems and the RF so that they can become interoperable as well as reconfigurable. And defining a radio as a network node identity in hardware, if you build it on an SCA architecture, these can be future upgradable and future proof. So this, in our opinion, is the way for the future networked communication. And coming to the last part of it, if we have to create such a network and maintain it, it has to have a very robust management system. That's the network management tool. The problems in the network management tool are not just monitoring and management, but also we have to provide status, configuration, fault, performance, and security of a network. And all this network has to be resident, not just in one node, but it can be distributed across all the nodes because it's almost a nodeless architecture. So these are the challenges in building NMS solutions. It must support fault management for either for discovery or isolation of the problem, ultimately to fix the problem. Configuration management and security management all has to be controlled by a very robust network management system. So performance management is also monitored by the network management tool. So in the end, I would like to just conclude by saying today's and tomorrow's airborne communication are actually networks of systems, and they are dynamic, and of course they will always be bandwidth constrained. The networks need to be reconfigurable, and reconfigurability can be addressed through a proper architecture and application. It might have looked quite simplistic, but when we start deploying these and designing and deploying them, they are designers' nightmares. But then the future is bright because there are so many technology enablers that are there today with us which can make our network communication a reality. Thank you for your listening.
Well, thank you, Dr. Kalatki. Actually, he's focused on airborne network, but actually networks from satellites to underwater in the network center cooperation is much more complex. But he has brought out very nicely. So maybe you can have one or two small questions. Yeah. Good. Dale Lal is ready. Please. Yeah. No, mic is not on. It's not on. This is a communication problem.
But Manjula madam, you are audible.
I shouldn't have had
without
this
a mic, you are audible.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Sir, my question is about this ECCM capabilities of the VHF radios. As a designer, what's your view as to what would be perhaps the maximum hop rate this, these frequency hopping radios can be deployed for effective operation? We keep talking, we're listening, you know, in the market that, you know, we're getting 1,000 hops radio, 2,000 hop radio and so on. So what's your view on this, number one question? Number two is that I also would like to know where are we as far as this ad hoc network capability, you know, indigenously? Where are we today, sir?
Thank you for very deep and very important questions. First is on the ECCM side. The question was, when we are saying frequency hopping is a very effective ECCM tool, then at what rate should you hop so that you are actually covered for your adversary's counter to ECM? Well, the answer is not so simple, but basically the textbook answer for this is that before we design the hop rate, actually things that are considered are, first of all, the propagation delay. Now, if you are going to apply over HF communication, for example, the hop rates are quite small. They can be even 10 hops to 100 hops per second. But if you are doing VHF or UHF communication, which are short-range communications, where about 20 to 30 kilometers of range, the propagation delay is much smaller than in the HF. So here, the hop rates can be much higher. Actually, there is a very, again, maybe it can be solved by an equation. In some textbooks, it's been given that not only the propagation delay, but also the payload, that's what data rate you would like to send, in whether it is a narrow band frequency hopping or a wide band frequency hopping. That means the payload that you want to communicate between a source and destination in just one go or multiple goes. So all this will actually go to design what kind of hop rates are to be designed. So the question that you rightly brought out is whether 1,000 hops per second is a good comfort margin, or 10,000 hops per second is actually what we should do. It's actually a kind of a, you know, cat and mouse game. If you design a system for 500 hops per second, today your adversary may be having the network management tool or a spectrum assessment tool which is much faster than 500 hops per second. If you are randomly hopping frequencies at only at 500 hops per second, and your adversary can spot onto your frequency at a rate of 1,000 hops per second, then even though you are randomly hopping, he may evolve an algorithm to actually follow you in your jammer, so that the very purpose for which you created an ECM or an ECCM could be neutralized. So keeping all these kinds of theoretical as well as the practical dimensions in mind, I think we can be very safe if you say in UHF communication up to about 1,000 hops per second is the current standard. And there are also people who say, why FH? Why not direct sequence kind of frequency? I mean, if not a frequency hopping, ECCM technique. There are some who say it's a hybrid system of FH plus DS is still better. So these are the kind of things probably there is no definite
so
answer.
So it is a game.
It's a game.
Game, actually. Okay.
I think the second question, I forgot your second question.
Wireless ad hoc networks.
So actually all these wireless ad hoc networks are a derivative out of what computer networks knowledge has come. Today as RF community, we are trying to take knowledge from a computer world or a LAN and WAN kind of networks and put them onto RF carriers. So MANET obviously is a kind of a network which is ad hoc and mobile in nature, but to deploy it in a very successful manner, we have to actually address all these multipath effects and the robustness of communication. It's not the networking protocol per se, because protocols, very huge body of knowledge is available in computer networks. A part of it can be applicable to even radios, but to communicate over a radio channel which is very lossy and very prone to multipath kind of distortions, how effective MANETs will become useful is actually a kind of study, I would say. But already people have deployed, and we ourselves are now deploying MANET over an SDR.
Okay, one last question for the day.
If you could kindly give us a realistic time frame when you could come out with a software-defined radio. And how do you address the vulnerability of the network-centric module which you've said, given that in 2007 Israel conducted the ETAC on Syria, and till date we've not come up with any alternatives per se?
Okay. Let me answer this question in a slightly different manner. When we say SDR, we are defining SDR as an SCA compliant SDR, that is the software communication architecture based SDR. Now, to answer when our, let's say, indigenous SDR will be ready, I can only comment that this, first of all, to the benefit of this audience, I must acknowledge that this is a DRDO and Bell initiative. It's a DRDO and Bell combined initiative to make this SDR happen. And it's in a very advanced stage of development, and prototypes are going to be trial evaluated in the next 6 months. Now, this is a prototype evaluation. Ultimately, to deploy it in numbers when the network-related issues come up, it will happen between 6 months to 1 year, where the kind of manufacturability of an SDR is going to be talked about. Now, this again is an SCA compliant SDR. The next question could be that how are you complying to an SCA which is international in class? So we, as a country, maybe we are also trying to develop our own kind of communication architecture where it's good enough for us to define it as an SDR. Earlier generation radios which were already there were software configurable. So actually they were there. But to convert it into an SCA so that interoperability and these kind of issues are better controlled in SDRs are, I think, about a year away.
Thank you. I think we'll thank Dr. Kalhatgi.